Yes. And now we're live. We're live. We made it. We're here. What's going on, Gordon?
Woo. Hey, I am just reading the comments here. I see Skeet Sayer saying that the Apple is not a PC. I fully agree. I don't think a Mac is a PC.
Is it a personal?
It is a personal computer. It's not a PC. And that's the one distinction that people really need to make.
Well, what's the difference between a PC and a Windows PC?
What do you mean?
Because you're just making PC synonymous with Windows, right?
Well, it is. It is unfortunately how everybody defines it now. But
so you're saying PC is Kleenex?
Well, it's a PC is clearly, if people go to Costco and Best Buy and they want to buy a PC, there's a Mac section because that is a Mac. It is not a PC. They understand that, or they buy a PC.
Or there's Chromebooks.
And yeah, Chromebooks are technically, I think most people would not view a Chromebook as a PC, even though is basically a PC.
Yeah, I don't know, man.
No, most people wouldn't. Most people would not see it as a PC because, fortunately from Microsoft's point of view, people view a PC as something that runs a Microsoft operating system. So that's just the reality. I kind of wish, you know, things were different, but that's just not the way it is. I just think that. But I do think it's a really weak argument to say, well, the Mac is a PC. Well, then why are you saying the Mac is better than PC? It can't be better than something it is. It doesn't make any sense.
Also, circular argument. By Apple's own admission, it's not a PC because they are the ones who made that I'm a PC, a Mac.
I mean, I don't get it. It's like, let's be honest. Yeah, it's a personal computer, but it is not a PC. And if it, you know, it's just stupid. It's just the normal stuff. What I'm wondering though is why Brad doesn't have a Celtic shirt.
Oh, good.
So I want to know. Well, no Celtic shirt there, Brad.
Maybe my jersey is in the washer right now, actually, so I can wear it this weekend.
Is it a Kyrie jersey? I'm guessing, probably.
No.
Oh,
who?
Huh?
Who?
Jason Tatum.
There you go. Nice.
Went to UC Berkeley.
Marcus Smart.
Right.
I want to get Marcus Smart next. Yeah.
Hey, it's a good team. Good game. You know, hey, what I like is it was a clean game without a controversy. That's, to me, is like, that's it. That's all we can ask for. It's going to be a slugfest. Who knows who's going to win? At the end, one of the other is going to win. So, that's it.
Yeah, basketball. Sports. Who's it? Amitsud asks, why no talk about coffee, donuts, or burgers?
Oh, that's for later.
Do you have coffee in your mug right there?
I do have coffee, yeah. Oh, okay. Pete's coffee.
Pete's coffee. Pete seems a little highbrow for you.
Well, I used to drink instant coffee, but my wife and her family are, because they're from Berkeley, so Berkeley is about Pete's coffee, because that's where Pete's was started. So that's I've gotten used to it. It's pretty good.
I, on the other hand, spent up today, and rather than having my typical diet soda cola, I have an official diet Pepsi. So.
Ooh.
Watch out.
Moving on up.
Oh, my God.
He's getting that PC World Chief money.
That diet Pepsi stuff is swill. Like, swill. I went to some place, and they're like, yeah, it's got Diet Coke. And they're like, well, Fountain is only Diet Pepsi. You want a canned Diet Coke? He said, yeah, that costs twice as much. Give me the Diet Coke in a can.
Have you tried Best Coast Burritos?
No.
No? It's like a local chain, like a burrito shop. Anyway, it's pretty good, but man, we kept being like, wait, why is our ticket so expensive? Like I looked in the burritos, you know, like, I don't know, the usual $12 Bay Area burrito cost, but then like it would come out to like $20, and I was like, what the hell? And then I looked at the thing, they're literally charging like $4 for a bottle of water and like, you know, $3 for a can of soda, and I was just like, oh my God, the markup on the drinks,
stadium pricing.
Yeah, the markup on the drinks is so bad there. So I'm like, all right, never buy a drink there. Just the burritos.
Yeah, no, that's bad. That's really bad. So we've got the sports and food banter and coffee out of the way because we got four topics to cover.
Oh yeah, we got a lot.
I want to get we should get going. We're gonna talk about desktop replacement laptops. Is HEDT dead? RTX 40 series and 6 cores are the new norm. So we ready to go?
Yeah, we got all the friends of the show here. Everyone's locked in and loaded. Be sure to buckle your seatbelt before the show starts. We don't want you thrashing around in your seat, and then you sue us for whiplash. Cool.
And happy Friday. Friday's a
happy Friday. Yeah, I feel
I'm on vacation after this.
Nice. I feel equal parts low energy because, you know, of a grueling week, but then equal parts like delirious and excited for the weekend. So it's like a weird mix of energy. So yeah, let's see how it goes. David Richards, movie banter. We'll just do that later. I'm sure it'll come up at some point. Gordon's going to make some sort of, you know, movie reference, and some of us will get it. Some of us won't. We'll see.
We were talking. I did grumble earlier about Star Trek, the motion picture. So that counts. Elena was saying something about Star Trek. The motion picture.
It's his daily quota. Every time he says that you drink. All right, cool. I think we're good. Yeah. Everyone else good? All right, then let me do this fancy ad read here, and we'll do. Oh boy, well, somebody's messaging me on Discord. I need to mute that streamer mode. Why does not? Okay, okay. All right, cool. Here we go. This video is sponsored by SK Hynix, the maker of fastest in class SSDs. The new. Oh, you know, I don't even have one. Let me hold on one second.
He's gonna go get one.
We're very prepared today. It's Friday.
Yeah, that's the best thing about Friday.
I'm so tired. I stayed up watching that game and did not get enough sleep.
What time did it end for Eastern?
11:30, 11:45, but then I was jazzed.
You know,
so I didn't fall asleep till late.
The sad thing is people who leave at the end. Because for people who don't know, the Warriors were in the lead the whole time. People thought it was going to be a standard issue Warriors win, but Celtics came back and like could not miss a basket, and then the Warriors could make a basket. But the sad thing is the Warriors fans who are at the finals, and if you're actually in that in there, you're paying what, thousands of dollars for a seat, and you leave with whatever, 6 minutes left, 5 minutes left. I don't care. You stay there till the end. Losers.
I was seeing the average price, including like when you average everything out, including the nosebleed seats, was $650 last night.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I'm staying for all those minutes.
Yeah. Well, you know, my theory is the people at these in the $600 seats, those are the ones that stay to the end. But the ones in the $5,000 seats are the ones like, no. I got to go. I got to get to my
The ones
Tesla.
With the $600 seats, they have access to the bar. They leave and they go to the lounge.
Because you stay, if you're a real fan, you stay to the end no matter what. That's just, you know. Yeah.
They've got TVs in the lounge. They got TVs in the lounge.
Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter.
All right, cool. I'm back. I have a drive, you know, for props, for fun. Here we go. I can do this. It's going to focus. Oh, there we go. Sweet. All right. Here we go then. Are we ready? Oh, you know, I got to be ready for this. And yes. Okay. Sorry. Oh, boy. Oh, okay. Just take that one. All right, cool. Here we go. It's Friday. This video is sponsored by SK Hynix, the maker of fastest-in-class SSDs. The new Platinum P41 PCIe Gen 4 NVMe SSD exhibits technical excellence driven by unmatched speeds and reliability. The Platinum series represents the company's flagship retail lineup geared towards gamers and content creators looking to turbo boost PC performance. Check out the link in the description in order to grab a Platinum P41 today and give your PC a huge upgrade.
In this episode of The Full Nerd, desktop replacement laptops are back. Is HEDT dead? And where in the world is RTX 40 series? And also, by the way, 6-core CPUs are the new normal. Welcome to episode 218 of The Full Nerd. I'm your host, Gordon Mong, with co-host Brad Charkas.
Good morning to my fellow Boston Celtics fans.
Eleni Yee.
I have no skin in these finals.
And Adam Patrick Murray is controlling the vertical and horizontal.
Yeah, I'm here. It's Friday. Equal parts tired and loopy and excited for the weekend. So ready to kick it off. We have a lot of crazy topics. We were like, man, we got nothing this week. And then we were like, wow, actually, we have a lot this week. I will say
everything.
I know, right? I will say before we start, be sure to tune in next week, because next week we're doing a we're bringing back the build challenge. We haven't done one of those in a while because, you know, it's been hard to get some parts, but now parts are out there. So if you want to participate in the build challenge, go over to our Discord. There's a link in the description. In the build recommendations section, I would love it if people put together a $1,200 PC using PC Part Picker with no peripherals, no monitor, no Windows key, anything like that. Just the PC itself. Put a link in there. Give a little description of, you know, what you targeted, what you aimed for. No theme. You know, some people are going for gaming. Some people might be going for content creation. Some people streaming. You know, have some fun with it. We're going to have our own. We're going to discuss it, and I'd like to be able to share some of you fine folks' builds as well. So be sure to go over there and put it in. But today we're talking about desktop replacements. Maybe you don't want to take that $1,200 and build a machine. Maybe you want to replace it with a laptop. Gordon, what do you think?
I think that you could argue for certain people, desktop replacement laptop is the way to go. And although desktop replacement laptops have really changed over the last couple years, they've gotten so thin and actually so portable that probably years and years ago they just would have been a laptop, and now they're you could barely call them what they used to be for desktop replacement laptops. And now, yep, interestingly, it seems like we're back there again, because Intel's new Alder Lake HX CPUs are finally starting to come out in some laptops. And if you don't know, we have a video on it, but it's a full Alder Lake desktop part mounted into a BGA and then soldered into a laptop. And over the existing Alder Lake H parts, which clearly are the rulers of laptop performance, the HX hammers the H part and is, yep, amazingly fast. And of course,
I was shocked.
I was too.
Those numbers are huge.
Yeah, because if you look, I mean, it's like, what, 30, 40% faster than an Alder Lake H, which, you know, there was really not much that could touch it anyway. So now they're cranking it up even more. But, you know, again, it is a 55 watt part. So it is going to use a lot of power. It uses considerably more power than the already not power friendly Alder Lake H. So you shouldn't expect a lot of battery life. And interestingly, a lot of people will always go like, oh, but bad battery life. It's like, to me, I think that doesn't make any sense, because
for these kind of laptops, especially.
For these kind of laptops, yeah. If you are going for a big 17.3-inch laptop to do either a portable workstation or a gaming laptop, you really should not get sidetracked by the whole battery life argument, because battery life on any gaming laptop, in fact, I would even argue the M1 Max, because everybody's like, oh, you should be more like Apple, M1 Max. If you take an M1 Max and you hammer that GPU and CPU in something very heavy duty, battery life is going to be really disappointing there too. You're not sitting there for 8 hours, you know, doing an all core encode on an M1 Max. It's just not going to happen. If you're using specialty circuits that are in there, sure, there's definitely things you can get. But for these big laptops, and even the M1 Max, the MacBook 16 is like 5 pounds. It's not exactly something light. There's a legitimate market for these big, heavy laptops. And I think people don't seem to get that, you know?
Yeah, people, if you're concerned about battery life, you're probably not the kind of person this laptop is intended for to begin with. Full stop. Like, you're looking for as much power as possible in a PC that you can carry with you to your clients or out in the field or something like that. That's 100% what these are. And you're going to be working connected to a plug 95% of the time.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd say probably like 99% of the time, you know, like the battery's there to be like, oh crap, I got to move from the desk to the table. Okay, you know, let me unplug it from the wall for a second.
Yeah.
So I mean, I think that's the hard point, right? Is that, like, if you would assume somebody's going to be plugged into power all the time, why not just get a tower? Or I'm sorry, plugged into the wall all the time, why not just get a tower? Then what's the point of having a laptop portable?
You can't bring a tower with you to work or out in the field or whatever.
Yeah. Yep. Even a small form factor, which you can get a lot more performance in than even these HX parts. You still have to carry panel. You've got all these, it's this big jumble of wires. Even though these things are, 7 pounds, you throw in the big 330 watt power brick.
Yeah, it's a big brick.
You're probably under, about 8 or 9 pounds, sub 10. Yep. That's still a pretty portable package to go somewhere, plug it into the wall, start doing stuff, right? So that's
I think that is the key. It's a full package, right? It's the monitor, keyboard, you probably hook up a mouse, have your own headphones to it, but or controller, who knows?
Well, you'd need a headphone.
Do your thing.
You'd need a headphone.
Oh, yeah.
Those things are
loud. It's pretty loud. That particular unit, and again, it's an engineering sample. Go look at our preview video. Read Elena's story about it on the website, but it's... It was like, we don't care about fan noise, basically. And I know a lot of people like
that.
They don't get it, but I'm really kind of like, I kind of dig the fact that Intel says, like, let's just damn the torpedoes, right? I'm just tired of your stupid, getting on us about its efficiency. To hell with you, then. We'll just crank it up to let's crank it up to 11, because they're like, this thing just hammers. I mean, M1 Max, I think the best score we saw out of Macworld was about 11,400 in Cinebench R23. That's a native M1 app. And this thing was 21,000, 22,000 almost.
Double the performance. Yeah.
to hell with your efficiency. We're just going to go for it. So it's really...
Right. Yeah.
Well, some people like muscle cars, right? Other people like Teslas.
Oh, yeah. But Skeet Sayer in the chat says, this is not a desktop part, Gordon.
Well, it isn't, but it is, right? Because as I understand it, Intel says we took Alder Lake dies and we put them into a desktop, basically. So it's... In fact, these laptops have PCIe 5 Gen 5 because the Gen 5 is validated for desktop. So... It's approved for these HX laptops, but
this isn't socketable.
It's not socketable. Yes. So it's not the classic, really. I mean, when you think desktop replacements of yore, you're thinking like a phone book, a phone book is this,
right?
Yeah. A phone book is this directory of people's phone numbers that people used to get. And they're really thick.
Yeah. Just in case you don't know.
In case you don't know.
And bring up
phones
a photo.
Are what people used to have that were connected to wires to each other. That's what those are for you younger people. But those I should have brought one of those earlier desktop players. I mean, those.
They were huge.
They were huge. They were like, 2.5 to almost 3 inches thick, and you wouldn't want to get hit in the head by one of those things.
Doubles as a weapon.
Yeah. So, it's not a desk, and some of those parts were actually socketable. In fact, there's a similar desktop replacements. They were built on a Ryzen. Remember somebody put a 5950X?
Really? Whoa.
Yep.
I do not remember.
Yeah, I forget. I think it's a Schenker. It's a European brand, and it is a massive, giant desktop replacement. It was a socketable, a 5950X built Ryzen laptop.
It feels like that used to be a lot more common. I remember companies like Origin PC and other boutique builders used to make laptops that had literally socketed desktops in them, and they were massive, but they massively performed. It feels like it's gone out of style the last few years.
Yep.
Yeah, it has, unfortunately. And this one thing it's also worth pointing out with these HX laptops is we will be seeing the return of sort of white book. They're calling them, are they OEM versions or something? Not OEM, but they're you will be able to get system integrators. So Origin and other companies like that will basically, buy some of the shells from a company, and then they do the final assembly and the specs based on what you want. And you'll be able to buy them from them. So that's kind of similar, but it won't be a socketed part. So in the socketed parts, unfortunately, laptops went out with Broadwell. Broadwell was the first BGA version for laptops. They went away from sockets. The argument is nobody ever does these upgrades. And if you, why make a laptop thicker? Why eat that extra thickness just to do a socket for the 1% of people that ever swap out a CPU, which I think sucks, because I like socketable CPUs in a laptop because you can upgrade them sometimes. But, I guess probably the last one that was done was Alienware's Area 51M, which was a socketable 9900K part with a custom GeForce card that they made. So that was probably the last socketable one I could think of.
It's a pity too, like, to lose that. At the same time though, given how frequently Intel changes their chipsets and motherboards, like, I can see why it kind of dropped out. Like, it'd be cooler almost to see that from the AMD side of things because of how long the support was.
God, that would that would be kind of a cool idea, right?
Yeah.
Your AM4 socketable laptop part.
We should do AM5.
It would be,
if you're listening.
That would be actually be kind of interesting if, because I was just saying that as you were saying that, like, that would be cool. Because if they did, because AMD has this long commitment to the sockets.
Yeah.
You know, I think the other limitations though aren't just simply on like Intel, like, oh, it's 2 years later, let's change codes, right? It isn't that. It really is also, there's real hard limits in the engineering and the motherboard for power delivery. Right. And I guess what you could say is you could design the laptop to be over-engineered so you could account for a very, very large power envelope. Then that increases the size, the cost, the power consumption. So pretty soon you really are getting to the point where it is barely a laptop. And I don't know if that would make sense, but that would be kind of cool if it were AMD based. I think the danger too, because I've seen this twice, because I'm a big supporter of upgradable laptops, especially socketable things. I love it. I will also say that no one buys them, and every time people make them, no one buys them and they go nowhere. So they get left holding a bunch of laptops nobody buys, which kind of sucks. But the other problem is every time companies have tried this, there have been two companies that have tried this. They've said upgradable laptops. You can upgrade your laptop. They basically look at the roadmaps from the vendors and they go like, oh, we designed this envelope, we'll be able to upgrade this laptop. That's what all the engineers say. So they, okay, let's market this as an upgradable laptop. And then the vendors go, oh, by the way, we've decided to go outside what our roadmap said and use more power. Mm-mm. And now you've marketed a laptop that can be upgradable. And in the United States, that basically means, oh, lawsuit time. So both of those vendors did end up in court because people said, oh, you promised me a upgrade and, you know, I couldn't get it. Yep. So the vendors pretty much, I think, after two failures to be able to do it, have been taught, yeah, let's not even bother to try this because you get sued and who wants to do that?
Well, on the plus side, it seems like this HX implementation like takes away some of that pain because it really is impressive how much faster this 12800HX is compared to even the 12900HK, and especially against last year's stuff. As you said, we've already done a review on it. I landed an article on it. You can go see the numbers for yourself, read all the numbers, but they're huge. Like, it's faster in content creation tasks than the 12900HK by like 30%. And compared to last gen stuff in the 5900X or HX, it's like 50 to 70% faster depending on the task. Like, it's truly amazing. Intel spent a lot of time talking about how these are ultimate workstation laptops, not gaming laptops. And I think that actually makes a lot of sense because if you look at your numbers, like, this is not tangibly faster than, even though it's way faster in content creation tasks, it's not tangibly faster in games than the 12900HK. So if you're looking for the ultimate gaming laptop, I would still recommend probably an HK or H series chip. But these HX things look like bees for people who need big desktop replacements.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it makes sense because you generally just don't need eight or 16 cores of high performance cores to run a game, unfortunately. So you really just need very high boost clocks under a few threads. So H and HK still gonna generally do better. And you know, this thing hasn't changed. You know, put all your money in the GPU, right? I would rather take a 3080 Ti with an H versus a HX with a 3070. It just makes more sense.
I will say it is a little confusing because I mean, it looks like a gaming laptop. It's got RGB all over the place, you know. it's got cherry switches for gaming, and the screen, I mean, for me, screen is number one for content creation. That thing doesn't live up. I don't care how fast it is. I need a better screen. So, well,
that was a pre-production, so it was
true.
It was a 1080p 360 hertz laptop. The final one will be a 4K, I think 120 hertz. From MSI, they may have some other ones.
Content creation, you definitely don't care about high refresh rate.
Yeah, but I want to say they Intel says like this is a workstation CPU, and a lot of the vendors are going to say, you know what? A lot of customers, they see HX, they see best thing better. They see Core i7 literally faster than Core i9 from H series. I want this. So that's why they are making this, even though it's not being marketed that. This GE77 Titan is clearly a gaming laptop, and I think people will buy it for gaming, even though...
And it does include options up to the 38.
Yeah.
We just got the 7. The
we got the lowest Ti. End. Yeah. We got the lowest end of the Titans, and it was still
and
whopping
Intel
everything.
Did say, I think in an interview at one point, they said that it's not the best chip for gaming on their stack, but it is still great for gaming. So yep, I can see why the vendors are leaning into it, because we've talked about this before on the show, where when you get that high in the stack for laptops, you just kind of throw all the bells and whistles on it, because you don't want to seem like you're necessarily cheaping out. And since it's not, since the Titan series, I don't think they've ever marketed it as like a prosumer or a content creator line.
It's
so
been a gaming
they're gonna have to put that RGB on there, Adam.
Yeah,
it's not gonna be there.
It's not even just about the looks of it. For me, like I said, it's the panel. Like, you know, to take it as a serious content creation laptop, I would trade a way better panel for the performance. I don't care how fast it renders. I care to have more color accuracy, things like that. So,
but you also have to realize there's definitely people who. They play games, so they want a high-end GPU. They don't want to give up on gaming performance, but then most of what they need is more cores. They need 16 Alder Lake cores. So like I'm a 3D modeler on the side. I do all that in the daytime on my laptop, and then at night I play games. So that kind of works. And you can't have a laptop without RGB and play games.
B-Maj, friend of the show, B-Maj asks, will we ever see a 27-inch laptop? That would be... very big.
You know, let me look.
I remember there was that one CES.
That'd be a mighty big lap.
I remember there was that one CES where we saw that laptop that had the really wide screen.
Yeah, I'm looking up the model. I reviewed it. Acer Predator.
Did Razer also have a project where
I think
like,
it was
they had like a bunch of screens that came out?
Yep.
21X, yeah, that's what it was. Yeah, and it had two of those 30-watt power bricks, right?
I remember
I was in San Francisco and we got that in. I had to help Melissa unbox it because it was a two-person lifted it out of the box.
That thing was...
I don't know how big the screen was, but it was ultra-wide.
It was a 21. So it was an Acer Predator 21X. You can... let me drop the review in the Slack channel for you, Adam.
All right.
But it was basically an amazing overkill laptop. I love this thing because I appreciate the fact that you do some crazy things like this. It was $9,000.
$9,000.
And it just had
$9,000.
It had a special little thing to hold the two power bricks together.
Oh, so you have to realize it was a wide aspect ratio, 21-inch screen that
and it was curved.
With and mechanical keyboard.
Like full mechanical keyboard.
How heavy was that again?
I don't know. What I know is it came in a custom rolling case.
Yeah.
So you bought this laptop. It actually came in a custom...
I guess I could afford to give you the case.
Well, I don't think it was actually a... It wasn't a real, like, OtterBox, you know, which would be, like, you know, $9 million. It was... I mean, a Pelican... It wasn't a real Pelican case. It was, you know, it was a pretty heavy-duty rolling case, like a Pelican case. You put the laptop in. It had all the cutouts for the power bricks.
Wow.
I mean, the thing was crazy.
Makes sense.
And, you know, it had a full-size mechanical keyboard, which it wasn't the first time it's done. MSI had done it a couple of years earlier. And actually, I have a laptop that goes back to the 1980s that had a mechanical keyboard on it. But it was a small run. I think they only made 200 or something. It was like a really small run.
Yeah.
And basically, I think they did the math like, we make 200 of these. How much would it cost? Well, it would cost $8,500 probably. And if they make 200 of them just to make and sell, they would still break even. But I don't know exactly how much it cost, but I can tell you it wasn't cheap to make one, you know, that few laptops. I thought it was a really kind of cool business model where you just make a very small run of laptops.
Yeah,
and it would for an exorbitant amount of money. So
And we were talking to them, and they were saying, like, yeah, if we do this, yeah, it's very high priced. Yeah, very small numbers, but it lets us try out this cool new stuff that we can then use, like, trickle down in the rest of the lineup, like, get experience with this stuff.
Yeah, that was fun. Yeah, desktop replacements, they're it's kind of heating back up, huh? I guess, especially, well, you know, and if you think about it, too, you know, 2020, a lot of people getting laptops, you know, this is probably the cycle, the time in the cycle where those plans were first put in place, like, oh crap, we need to get some more desktop replacement laptops out there, you know, and it takes a while to get a product cycle going, so maybe this lines up with, you know, that thinking.
I wonder if it's also the part of it is like the people who need portable workstations and, you know, laptops like this, they're on the move a lot, like a lot of traveling nurses, like they'll go and they'll work in a city for 2 months and they want to bring their gaming computer with them, or a lot of soldiers put them in their, you know, foot lockers, and the laptop goes in there nice and small and doesn't take up a lot of space. Those are the people that I've heard who really kind of like fit this kind of like, although most soldiers are probably not buying $4,000 laptops.
You'd be surprised. Mm-hmm. I've seen a lot of people share their laptop. Yeah.
No, I know. It's just a lot of money.
You have nothing else to do. Like if you're stuck on a base, I mean, it makes sense to invest in something that, you know, you're going to use and it'll keep you occupied.
How does that work though? When like, if you're a soldier and you got to go somewhere, and like you're playing a game, so like, you know how when you're playing games now, you can't just quit.
You just close the lid.
You don't close the lid because then you're quitting on your team.
You're just like AFK, and you have like something that jiggles the mouse so you don't get booted for inactivity. I don't know.
I was just thinking like, oh, we gotta go, Sarge. I got 20 more minutes in this game. Yeah. That's what my kids are always like. I need 20 more minutes.
I know. I do that too. Yeah. Like Lindsay's like, hey, I got dinner ready. It's still warm. And I'm like, oh, this match is almost over. I promise.
And the problem is people who don't play games don't understand. They're like, you're just because like they're playing games like they're playing Tetris or something like that or Wordle. And they consider that gaming. Well, you could just put it in standby. It's like, that's not how it works. You know, that's just not that's not how it works.
Yeah. Well, you know what does work, Gordon?
What?
SK Hynix NVMe SSDs. I've been since SK Hynix last sponsored the show and some builds and stuff. I've been using the SK Hynix P31 and S31 in the rig at home after we had built it. Those things have been rock solid. I'm not reviewing them. They're, you know, it's just anecdotally I've been using them and they've held up well. We did build a new production rig with 12th gen and a 3080 Ti for a DaVinci Resolve and other things, not just DaVinci Resolve. It'll work for plenty of things as well. But yeah, I put a couple SK Hynix Platinum P41 SSDs. So these are Gen 4 now. So switching over to Gen 4 and moving around large files. I'm probably going to feel it. So I'm excited to try it out.
I tell you what. You didn't review it, but we actually did a review of that SSD today, which had nothing to do whatsoever with the sponsorship. Our SSD reviewer had gotten the thing as part of his regular thing, and he finds that it absolutely rocks. It won our Editor's Choice Award. It's just a lick slower than the absolutely fastest PCIe Gen 4 SSDs, but it costs quite a bit less. So that's an excellent combination. So today, you know, 4.5 stars, Editor's Choice Award.
Nice.
Okay. Well, I had no idea that was not planned. But I will say if you want to grab a Platinum P41, please check out the link in the description. It is trackable. That's how, you know, they're going to track to say if the sponsorship went well. So if you are in the market and you would like to get one, please use the link. We would appreciate it. But you know, just wanted to give you a heads up that it is tracking. And yeah, it's purple. You know, the last color scheme was yellow. This one's purple, if you like purple.
Cool. Adam, if you were a good place for a brand new SK Hynix Gen 4 drive, feels like it might be in an HEDT system.
Yeah, right? Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, that's what you would think. You know, you want
transition.
Yeah, you want a high-end desktop part. But, Gordon, I've heard this kind of sprung up in a lot of places.
Where is this?
Because Gordon, when I first brought this up, Gordon was like, wait, why are we talking about this? It's not dead. And I was like, well, actually, I just saw some fine folks over on Discord bring that up recently. There was a nice chatter over there of like, wait, is it truly dead? I mean, Gordon, What do you think?
Well,
seem to think it's dead.
I don't understand. Well, because there have been rumors of, you know, Alder Lake X coming out later this year. So that's why
it's rumors. I think it's more like, when was the last time Threadripper was kind of a big deal? Sure, we saw Threadripper Pro refresh earlier this year, but that was very, you know, that was OEM only. It's very select. It's not coming separately. So, you know.
People basically think that high-end, for people who don't know, high-end desktop is dead because there hasn't been service there from Intel or AMD. Is that the main reason?
There's a couple different reasons. We actually had a piece right on this today too.
I totally forgot about that. And he's making a video about it too. So that's
another thing. Piece on it.
Yeah.
That was actually in the works before a week or two ago. Puget Systems, boutique builder Puget Systems, actually did a big post talking about where are all the HEDT parts. Yep. The issues people are having is basically both DIY Threadripper parts, which are Threadripper 3000 still, as well as Intel's own Core X Extreme Edition chips. They haven't been touched since 2019. And according to Puget Systems, like 15 to 25% of their workstations were still being Threadripper because people need the expanded memory capacity. People need all the extra PCIe lane, stuff like that. And in the last month or two, they are completely unable to source Threadripper parts DIY anymore. Threadripper Pro 5000 is out, but you can only get those in select Lenovo pre-built workstations. So right now, there's really no high-end desktop options out there for people who would want to buy them. And they're 3 years long in the tooth, even if you were in that market.
Well, I think the other part of it, too, is that, like, hey, when Threadripper came out, it was like, oh, my God, look at all these cores. And now, I mean, with the 5950X, with the 12900K, I mean, we're getting a lot more cores than most people probably even need. So it's kind of, I think it's both ends, right? The top and the bottom kind of eating into it. Like, honestly, I mean, for me, maybe it's just more like, what is high-end desktop? I mean, what is HEDT? I mean, I would almost consider 12900K that, I mean, it's a lot of, it doesn't mean cores, doesn't mean PCIe lanes. Like, we just did that build and I was just like, oh, I've got all these PCIe lanes on Alder Lake. Like, you know.
I hear you, because it's long been hard to justify buying that high core count CPU for most people. And it never really made sense, because both companies really marketed it to that, both to, you know, actually consumers in a lot of way. But I think they were mostly Halo parts, right? For you market it because you want people to get excited and jazzed for the platform, for the PC. So it keeps people excited about it. For practical purposes, it really was best for somebody, you know, who really needed a core count. So it didn't make sense for a normal person to buy one, but for the person who could or needed it, it was totally worth it. And I would say this is just a normal PC problem where we start hand wringing because, oh my God, there hasn't been a part in 3 years, it must be dead. But I just don't get that, because you don't have to introduce these parts every 12 to 18 months. They're clearly extremely expensive. They're incredibly small volume. They don't sell a lot of these parts. The motherboards are stupidly expensive. The power supplies to run them are expensive. Everything is expensive associated with it. And I say all that, but I'm certain there will be still parts. Well, there will be chips here. I'm just looking, because I was like, I couldn't understand where this is coming from, because here's a hot hardware story written by Paul Lilly. Hey, Paul, how's it going? Intel Alder Lake X with 56 cores allegedly coming to throw down with Threadripper. That was a story Paul wrote on Hot Hardware in April. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. And part of that is because Ada 64 release notes preliminary support for Intel Alder Lake X CPUs.
Well, hopefully that we do indeed start seeing updated refreshes of both Extreme Edition and Threadripper, because there is a market for it. Like you're saying, they're niche, but Puget Systems is here saying, hey, here's, you know, all of our sales data from January 2020 through now, and Threadripper systems peaked at 35% of all workstation sales, but it's been a consistent 15 to 20% of their sales, and now it's just dropped off the face of the earth. they say that you know, their customers need the cores. They don't necessarily need to step up to full blown works like Epic Class and Xeon, because those cost a whole lot more.
Right. Mm.
But they need more cores. They need the PCIe expansion. They need the memory stuff. And right now, like, there's no options for those people right now. So that's why all that talk is going around.
I'm honestly a little surprised that people are talking about this without remembering that we've been in a pandemic for the last two years. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, to me, it makes kind of sense that it could just be tabled for now because, mm-hmm. you know, they wanted to redirect their resources to what they knew they could sell, like how much available silicon there was, you know, the judging the demand that was out there. And maybe it's just that it's just severely delayed because, you know, of all the global supply woes that have been happening.
Yeah. And then plus both companies have been very, very busy on mobile. They have been busy on server. They have been busy on desktop. They've been busy. You know, I don't understand how we just get from like, it's a long cycle to immediately it's dead though.
I mean, it wasn't that long though. They were actually, the Threadripper was coming out, what, every 2 years for a bit? So
yeah, 2 years.
And it was just like, look, we gave you double the cores. Now it's double more. Like, and it was just like, oh my God.
Just drop the mic.
It was mind blowing. Yeah.
Yeah. But
so to go from that to this long delay, I can see why people are like,
Well, yeah. I agree 100% with everything y'all are saying. I think the fact that they do have to prioritize certain chips over others is probably a big part of this. But, it doesn't change the fact that for people who are actually looking to buy systems right now, yes, you can get a 16-core Alder Lake or Ryzen 7000 system, but then you don't get all that expandability. And if you need that expandability, your only option right now is to step up to a server class, workstation class. Yeah. Those are ridiculously priced.
How important is the memory, was ECC memory for that kind of like class of work?
You mean I mean, Threadripper could run non-EC RAM, so it's always important to have as an option for some people who want it.
You need it.
You will get into arguments with people who say everybody should be running ECC. In fact, they're saying literally right now, cosmic rays are inducing errors into our laptops and all the computers here because
we're not running
ECC RAM. But how do you know if there's errors being induced? So every pixel or every bit is being moved around. You don't know.
What happens when I make a mistake here on the show, like the music plays or something. Like it's because I don't have ECC RAM.
It's actually in your brain pushing it up. But there's ECC RAM is very important. There's a real reason for some people to have it. I think the ECC crowd overstates its having to have it sometimes. It's just like, my argument has long been, you know, I think, you know, 8 billion computers built without ECC RAM generally being fine is proof that not everybody really has to have it. But so you get down the rabbit hole of saying whether you need ECC or not. But the density, you definitely need the density because, I mean, although we're going to get to 128 gigs on DDR5 systems really soon, right? So. But, you know, we live this is not in a world where people we've gone far enough. We don't need to go further. I'm sure somebody will want, you know, half a terabyte or a terabyte of RAM in their workstation machine.
Well, two questions. One of them from me. What's the rumors on the Sapphire Rapids? Is it going to make friend of the show Dr. Ian Cutress happy and it's just going to be like 64 E cores?
I'm. It's basically what are they saying? It's basically Sapphire Rapids. Oh no, wait. I didn't read all.
I'm sorry.
All
Alder Lake X, isn't that what?
Rumored that Alder Lake X could be offered with up to 56 cores across 4 dies. So they would all be performance cores, most likely.
Yeah. See, and Dr. Ian Cutress wants all.
He wants all
cores.
E cores.
Yeah. Yeah, that'd be interesting. Go for it.
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say a question from the chat from Stefan, friend of the show. Stefan asked, is HEDT CPUs in servers more Intel or AMD based? Do we know if AMD was able to kind of crack into that?
It's still primarily Intel, but AMD has been making some big inroads in servers.
Yeah, it's all gravy for AMD. They have far more market share in servers than they they've had in a long, long, long time. So
probably ever.
Ever. They did pretty well in the Optron days, but I guess probably not.
Okay.
I mean, the plus I imagine the amount of compute consumption is way higher now because everybody's always buying everything all the time up there.
Yeah.
But they are making a ton of money off servers. So, and it's, again, it's just gravy because they haven't had that revenue before.
Well, and it sounds like a friend of the show, Mr. Seven Digit, says Google Cloud will be using the new Epic chips. I don't know. Yeah. I haven't seen about that. Also, speak of the devil, Tiago from Classical Technologies, he's here. He's in the show. Welcome.
In the chat.
Yeah, glad to have you here. He's the one who wrote the article. It's in the top of PCWorld.com. Go check it out. Good article. We're going to make a video of it, too. I'll get back to you on that, Tiago.
I do. It's a good story to read, but do you think, I don't want to get it. I do believe, though, it is dead to most of us. None of us in this room needs more than 16 cores. So does that make it dead?
Go ahead.
I was going to say, is it really dead to Adam and people who are doing the video work on our team?
Well, it was a legit look. I did look at Threadripper for this streaming box because I was like, you know what? I want to go all out. I want the cores. Once again, the problem I had was the compatibility with Blackmagic capture cards. Mm-hmm. I've seen problems with that, and then some of the software I use, like the streaming software I use right now is Livestream Studio. There's some people saying that, you know, the Threadripper support was not great there, so it was just like, okay. I think that's, you know, better. for those prosumer kind of things, you know, because we're not running any high-end gear here, like a lot of the prosumer stuff just is not tailor-made for Threadripper. It gave me pause. It probably would have been fine, but it, you know. Yeah.
I mean, like, the original...
Puget definitely recommends them.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Definitely for expansion capabilities, it's worth it. But I just think for most normal people, I mean, workstation's one thing, but in Puget, that's what they do. They sell workstations primarily. I just think, like, I would agree in a lot of ways because the performance you're getting out of 12th Gen and Ryzen, you know, 5950X is like, what?
Yep.
How could you ever justify that for a regular person? So...
Tiago made some good points in his article. He made many good points. Hi, Tiago. But one of them being that high-end desktop used to be not just the pinnacle of workstation builds, but also gaming builds. Like, if you want the best gaming thing back in the day, you would go for HEDT. But that's really not true anymore. So it really does seem like it's died down for that. That was a significant portion of the crowd, and I don't think it's there anymore.
Yeah, I mean, a 6-core Golf Town was HEDT back then, right? So, and you know, small sockets were 4 cores, big socket was, you know, 6, and then that was sort of expanded to 8. And then it sort of like, it got a little crazy with the arms war because they started pushing more and more higher core counts and crazy things. I wonder if there should be more space. It should be like, you know, 6, sub 20, 24 small sockets is everything for consumers, and then sort of like, you just like, let's skip that like 32 core 40-ish range, let's go all the way up to where you're to the 50 to 60 core range, so you sort of like crank it all the way up.
Hopefully it comes back.
Hopefully.
If I would have been smart, I would have put the fourth topic after this one because it kind of leads into it, but whatever. I didn't plan. It's Friday. So we're going to transition into GPUs. I have nothing fun there, but I will say that I was in... the closest Best Buy to me was in Emeryville. I went there over the weekend, and I was like, you know what? I'm going to stop by the PC building cage over there at Best Buy. I've heard, you know, a lot of places be like, oh yeah, GPUs are stocked everywhere. People are sending photos of like a Micro Center is just being fully stocked with GPUs, and in other places like. I can't think of the name of the other place, but I have a photo here. You guys are just gonna have to look on the stream, but I took a picture of the cabinet, and they only had 5 GPUs, and they were all RTX 2060s. They did have some CPUs, some SSDs, some.
Wow.
RAM.
2060s. Yeah, I was just like, so I just popped in real quick, and I should have like went over to somebody and been like, hey, you know, what's inventory been like? But also I was just surprised because I expected especially with all this talk of like there's an overabundance of GPUs and prices going down, that a local Best Buy, I judge a local Best Buy as being like kind of the place to be like, oh, okay, then it's really really a lot of a lot of stuff there. So
it's not too bad. The fact that they had any GPUs is better than nothing.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. No, I mean, it was just interesting. I poked in and I expected to see better than that. I expected to see better than that.
You know what I didn't see in that box, Adam?
Oh, I don't know. Please tell me.
I didn't see any RTX 40 series cards in there.
Yeah,
I thought it's supposed to be out by now. It's July.
Well, that's funny because I feel like. I feel like both Keith and I have talked about this, where I was like, nah, I don't think 40 series is coming anytime soon. Like, I you know, like maybe by the end of the year. But Gordon was like, oh, yeah, it doesn't matter. You know, they can just announce it next month at Computex. You know, they don't even have to launch it. They just want to announce it. But this new report from Igor's lab says otherwise, huh? Brad, do you want to sum it up for us?
Yeah, sure. So, yeah, we were talking about that recently, about all the rumors about these potentially launching in July. And they still could do that. But Igor, he's awesome, awesome. What is he, Germany? Yeah, Germany-based testing site. He used to run Tom's Hardware Germany before he went solo. He's got legit sources. He put out an article this week saying the reason we aren't seeing all sorts of performance estimates and stuff like that for the 40 series yet is because vendors still don't actually have the chips in hand to create their own custom cards and stuff like that. It's still in the electrical and thermal design guide, bill of materials release kind of stages of things. And they still have a lot of work ahead as far as engineering validation, design validation, all kinds of other stuff like that. So it's, according to his sources, it's not looking like the RTX 40 series is going to launch anytime soon, because this stuff takes a few months if it is indeed where he is at, if it's indeed where he's saying they're at based on his sources. So, and I was actually, once those rumors came out, I started asking around some folks I know, and I was hearing, I can't say too much, but I was hearing roughly the same thing, like, I don't expect to see cards in July based on what I'm hearing from folks either, but
or even an announcement. I think what Gordon was saying is like, oh, they could announce it and then, you know, like just to pull the rug out from under AMD or Intel, but and then not have any cards. But also, I mean, they got burned pretty bad last time they did that. So,
and if they they did that with the 3090 Ti, Igor makes that point. And if they do indeed still have all this engineering, design, working sample validation stuff to go on, it would be hard for them to even announce it because they can't be 100% sure of the final frequencies and stuff like that until they have it all wrapped up.
So basically a fall launch is looking like it.
Probably. Assuming all the
September-ish
stuff is true.
Yeah.
So that probably means standalone once E3.
I mean, there's no E3.
There's no E3 technically, but I do know people are going to be gathering or are gathering right now in LA from what I can tell. So that's happening.
Summer Games Fest and stuff.
It's happening right now.
I guess the argument would be they don't even need anything anymore.
Well, they don't need a trade show.
Nobody needs a trade show to launch it, especially something as big as 4000 series. They can just do it. They can do it anytime they want.
Oh, yeah.
And people tune into the stream and it's done. It's just, you got to do it when you're...
Well, also, I still think like it would be such a bad look right now, like with all these, I mean, sure, maybe I didn't see it at my local Best Buy, but you know, there are plenty of reports of lots of GPUs out there, prices continuing to drop. You know, if they get stuck with all these GPUs on shelves and then Nvidia's like, oh yeah, by the way, 40,000 series, you know, companies are not going to like that.
No.
Across the board, the whole supply chain would not like that. Consumers might, because then it'll drive prices down, but.
I mean, so it sounds realistic then. Clearly, people jumped the gun when everybody were saying it's imminent. When they started saying, there were a lot of reports based on...
In the last week or two, there's been a bunch of them,
That is imminent, but it sounds like it's clearly not imminent. So that's I guess that's better. Do you just go like, well, you know what? I'm going to buy a card now. I'm not going to wait.
It depends on the price. Like Keith said in his recent video, like I've been saying, like paying MSRP for a card that's 2 years old at this point is hard. But on the flip side, you've been struggling real hard to get a card for 2 years, you can find what you want for MSRP. Like, you have no idea what tomorrow holds at this point in the electronics market.
Also, the trend has not been to hold to the previous generation's MSRPs. So even though it's 2 years out and you'd be paying MSRP for that, that doesn't mean you'd be saving any money or, you know, how do I put this? You would not be paying that same price for the newer technology, most likely. So you'd still kind of face this conundrum of, okay, will I save some money by going older or do I just pony up the cash for newer?
Yeah. Also, so yesterday, a friend of the show on Discord, Duke Nukem, sorry, I'm going to get you there, posted a XFX Speedster Mark 319 Radeon RX 6900 XT on, it was a Slick Deals on Newegg for $900. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
6900 XT for $900. That's a lot of power for $900. I don't know what MSRP is for a 6900 XT. Do you remember, Brad?
It was $1,000.
Okay. Yep. So, I mean,
so.
And that was for reference versions, the higher end custom versions like that Quickster Merc, which I believe I reviewed. If I didn't review the 6900 XT version, I reviewed the 6800 XT and it rocks. Yeah. So, having that $100 under MSRP is great.
Yeah, that one was like 1200, what I wanted to say.
Probably.
Yeah.
1250.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, let me see if Slick Deals still says it. Oh, it's expired. Yeah.
I see. I have to ask some legitimate buying advice. Should I buy this GTX 1080 Ti for buy now for $400? It's a pretty good price.
Yes, that was $1,200, the MSRP for that card.
Wait, you would or wouldn't?
Sorry.
No, we're talking about the Merc.
Yeah, yeah, the Merc. So it's $300 off MSRP. Anyway, sorry.
That's pretty good, actually.
Yeah.
So,
don't get your hopes up for RTX 40 series in July. It might still happen. Who knows? Like, maybe they can get to the point where they can make the announcement, like we were saying before, to try to preempt Intel Arc. But I wouldn't expect to see cards anytime soon.
It almost feels like Nvidia at this point, they're just going to, a lot of them worry about Intel at this point and just do new cards.
Yeah. Well, I agree. I think part of the reason that, I think I said this in a recent show, part of the reason we're seeing such a big flood of cards on the market right now is because they were gearing up to do a shock and awe kind of thing. Because this is when Arc was originally supposed to launch. but yeah, at this point, Arc's not going to be the mid-range card it thought it was going to be, I think, when it comes out.
But also, to be fair, 40 series, when it gets announced, is probably going to be the higher-end parts anyway.
Rumors are saying 4090 to start, and then 4080, 4070.
But I do wonder where it feels like it's going to leave Arc in an even worse place, because they were always rumored to be in the 3070 range in performance, and everybody expected that 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's going to really come down to price now. Like, that's what's going to make or break it for them.
Well, actually, maybe this is a play by Intel to actually drive down the prices right now for 30 series, because even if they come out higher with 40 series, all these 30 series cards are going to be sitting there at lower prices. So even if Arc tries to come out and match it, they're like, well, you got 40 series that beats it, but it's more expensive, or you got 30 series that matches it and it's cheaper.
There you go.
Yeah, but I wonder if that then the pricing pressure pushes 3080s down. And if it can't compete with 3080 TIs, of course, who knows what it's going to cost.
Well, I know that's what I'm saying. Like, if a 3080 launches at what the Arc 3070 equivalent would be, then yeah, I mean.
Right. So then what do they do? Do they, I don't know. Then it just feels like you go with just selling it to OEMs.
It's gonna be very interesting to see what they do, because of this, since this is like with their first launch in forever, they're probably also gonna have to be very careful about the perception they set by what price point they set, right? Yeah. So I think they've actually got themselves in quite a bind, I feel like.
Yeah, it's pretty rough.
Yeah, and a lot of that's just because there's no parts. Because it would have been an instant hero 12 months ago. But now people
6 months ago.
Even 6 months ago, right?
Yeah.
I don't know where it's gonna fall at this point. There's definitely content creation, those kind of other stuff you could maybe argue for it, but gaming as old as what moves eyeballs. So
I mean, I think the only, I mean, it's probably not where they're going to go, but the only place gaming wise is low end, you know, a 4080. If Intel can come out with the new 4080, where it's just like, oh man, 4080 is like $120. You get three free games, you know, sweet. Okay.
I just don't think.
But yeah, like they're probably not going to want to go there.
Yeah, I just don't think that's how it's
going. You mean like a 480 or?
I'm sorry. 480. Yes. Okay, RX 480.
It's a Friday. I'm like, wait a second.
Not 4080. I'm sorry. So many numbers.
Well, I mean.
So if it becomes the new, you know, champion RX 480.
Could they get themselves into trouble by dumping these cards? Because everybody's like, you're going to go, well, you're gonna, they're going to push out ARC. Was it Battle Mage? I forget which one this was.
Mm-hmm. So ARC. This one's Alchemist.
So we're looking at maybe 30-70-ish range. People are like, oh, well, you're going to have to dump them. I don't know if they can dump them and then not get into trouble too, because that, you know, Intel is always sort of like in that sort of problematic spot with regulators. And I wonder if that's an issue for them. But I don't know what the hell they do now, because it's just like, where has it been, man? Where has it been? I just,
it's a rough spot. However, I do think before we get too down on it, like, AMD has took a while to get to where they are with the Radeon series, so it doesn't necessarily mean that they're out for the, you know,
of course.
Yeah. And even if this part doesn't blow everybody's socks off, Intel, unlike the previous attempts, they just simply can't go home. Like, oh, let's just, we can't do this, because the future is to compete with Nvidia and AMD here, so they have to do it. So people think they're just gonna take the ball and go home. It's not gonna happen. They're gonna stick around, but I think definitely ARC expectations are definitely very tempered now, right?
Well, I will say, if they do continue to lean into content creation, I mean, that is one spot where I'm like, hey, I have a box that's just work based, and there is legitimate reason to get an ARC for work over gaming. Like, maybe gaming, it's like, oh no, this isn't. Yeah. But for work, it's worth a look. You know, that could be something. We'll see.
I kind of almost
software optimization, right?
I want a PC that has all three cores. Actually, all four. So I want QuickSync. I guess you'll get that through ARC, though. So if you get QuickSync through ARC, so I want ARC, I want GeForce, and Radeon. Because, like, you just don't know which different apps. You kind of like, oh, well, this application does best on this one, and you just kind of switch to the best processor for that application. That'd be...
You could probably pull that off in a HEDT platform.
There you go.
Yeah,
try else a lot.
I feel like we're getting insight into how you would redesign ATX.
Well, it'd be pluggable GPU sockets or something. I don't know. Yeah, no, that, yes, you're talking about failure. That's like,
that's funny. Well, we do, real quick before we move on, we do have a super chat from James Cagney. The $25. Thank you so much. Wow, I really appreciate it. Says, how long will the 12 gigs of VRAM be good for? They just got a Red Devil 6700 XT, and they got the 12 gigs instead of 8 gig 3070, and they like that the drivers are open source. How long do you think 12 gigs is going to service them?
For the lifetime of that card, you'll be all right.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I think there might be games that, like, if you're playing at 4K with everything cranked to the absolute max, there might be, like, the next generation Doom game will have its version of nightmare settings. You might have to crank that back, but practically speaking, that'll be totally fine.
That definitely. Yeah. And then Eternal Duoe gave us 5 euros. Thank you so much. A friend of the show said, just remember that the 4M figure for ARC was encompassing all SKUs plus laptop. They were never going to be many discrete desktop parts. So.
Yep. Yeah.
Good point. Speaking of desktop parts, that's it, Gordon. 4 cores can pack it up and go home. 6 cores is the new normal.
Yeah, isn't that crazy? This is based on the latest Steam survey, I think, right?
Yep, yep. May 2022.
The hardware survey.
And I want to point out here, because I know people who follow the Steam survey will say, well, it's really unpredictable, the results you get there. So the caveat is, it's not like an actual survey. It does seem very random. So, but
you mean,
and
random?
They never actually explained their methodology behind it. Yeah, there's all kinds of things, but it is something that they've been putting out month after month for years now.
Right. So take that. So just understand, it's not a total, you know, 100% insight into people's computers, but 6 cores are now the dominant CPU, right?
Yep. Yeah. This month, for the first time ever, last month, I guess it is.
Oops, wrong chart.
6-core CPUs are now in the lead. They have 33.60% of, they're in founded 33.60% of all Steam surveyed systems, whereas 4-core CPUs are down to 33.2. So for the first time ever, quad cores have been dethroned. Wow. And on top of those, 6-cores having the biggest thing, 8-core CPUs are good for another 18.68%. So between 6 and 8-core CPUs, that's over half the Steam market now.
That's impressive.
That's crazy. But it also, you know, and I wish they would break it out with, these are not laptops? Are these just desktops, or does it include
everything.
Laptops?
Everything.
Oh, okay, so. Everything. Yeah. So, I mean, and laptops, you gotta assume laptops make a good chunk of this too, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. But yeah, I mean, there's, you know, 6-core CPUs are actually pretty common in even budget gaming laptops these days. And then, of course, you have Ryzen on the other side where you're getting 8 cores in thin and lights. So, wow, 33%.
Hey, we're officially here in the 6 and 8-core era, which is great. I think a couple of interesting things to pull out of there is just how slow it takes for mass adoption to change in the PC industry. Because, you know, the first-gen Ryzen parts came out 5 years ago at this point, you know, democratizing all these cores, and it's taken 5 years for it to become the dominant CPU core count. And people are always asking, when is that going to be the new standard that developers target for, 6 cores, 8 cores? And I think the fact that quad cores still have a third of the market shows it's still got a ways yet.
Yeah. Developers don't. They don't switch overnight. They want to sell to everybody from 2 cores to 16 cores. So it's not going to change overnight for PC gaming. But it's getting better. It's getting far better than it ever has been before.
Oh, yeah. This is all great stuff for people, I think. 50% of people, 6 or 8 cores. That's great.
Yeah. I will say there's... sorry to tell you this, Gordon, but if you scroll down, you look at the physical CPUs for OS X for Mac... the majority, 39%, are on 8 cores. So, man, we're lagging behind the Mac.
Wait, what? Let me find this.
Yeah, because they break it up between Windows, OS X, and Linux. Linux, the majority is only 4 cores. Oh, man. Peter, well, you got to explain this to us.
A lot of people are throwing Linux on their older boxes.
There you go. But, yeah, no, that is, you know, and... Yeah, man, I wonder also if like that 5600X, 3600, you know, like if that is like definitely the sweet spot for people picking up CPUs. I don't know what the Intel equivalent is that has 6 cores, but is it an i5?
Yeah, 12600K, 400K?
12400.
Yeah.
I do want to point out, though, that like it's not like 4 core is like dead. Like the percentage difference is what 0.4% at most. Yeah. Well, actually, a little less than that.
It's always been within about 1% of it for the past couple months. So
I think for me this is more interesting because now that we're starting to see that change, I'm kind of wondering how quickly we'll see it continue to trend that way. If it's still going to be that slow kind of progression that you were talking about, Brad, or if there's just going to be this kind of sudden sea change at some point where it just goes and it just kind of takes off.
I wouldn't be surprised if whether or not GPUs continue to be widely available makes a difference, because I think there's a lot of people looking to upgrade still, and when they do, they're going to be getting those 6 and 8 core chips.
Yeah. I'm also wondering if it's going to be influenced by when video game development really starts taking advantage of more cores.
Consoles have 8 cores. Gordon, we're still 2 cores behind consoles, Gordon, and 2 cores behind Mac. What the hell? Actually, you know what? This is horrible news.
Yeah, you also have to realize that you're talking about there's still 90% of the world runs Windows PCs. So you have a much much larger market. So it's not a big deal.
They've sold a lot of consoles, Gordon.
I kind of think that I wonder if developers are going to get to the point where they really use all these.
It will at some point. I still think it's slower going than most people hope for.
Yeah. I mean, that's good news for people hanging on to budget hardware too, though, or can only afford budget hardware.
It's just that, you know, we've had, you know, eight 8 cores on console for how long now? What is it, original Xbox something something?
Well, I mean,
well, those are Jaguar cores. Yeah.
I know.
There's a difference between real 8 cores or actual 8 cores and like
it was like 8 E cores.
Calling it 8 cores.
Yeah, it was like 8
they,
E cores.
Yeah, they were like 8 E cores, but I worse than 8 E cores,
not
to be
8
honest.
P cores.
Yeah. I think the but the problem is I've been hearing the narrative of, oh, well, because consoles have 8 cores, it will benefit the PC. It's like, it's been like years. And like, I ain't seen the benefit, really.
It has. Yeah. There's a lot more games that are using more cores than they used to. Like, it definitely is, you know, like also, open world games, the racing games that we see these days.
Also, I thought they would, in the console at least, they would designate 1 or 2 of the cores for system overhead, so like yes. The games still only effectively had like 6 cores.
Well, but I mean, even there, it's 6. But I'm just saying, even it feels like we are. It's a long way from us getting to the point where game developers go, we're gonna run all these, you know, threads for, you know, physics, sound, whatever stuff, or we're gonna run them on games. Actually, there was a demo I saw. I was actually kind of impressed. I saw it. Intel was in New York, and they showed me a laptop running Alder Lake in this game. I have to ask them what the game was, but it was specifically tuned for Alder Lake mix of E cores and P cores. Where I mean, it used a lot of threads, but the game, the timing of the threads are actually offset for the E cores. Apparently, so like, okay, we're doing this sort of like housekeeping stuff. We're going to throw this to an E core. So the game engine was actually intelligent enough to know, like, okay, we're going to throw this to E cores, we're going to throw this to P cores. So that was very promising.
Yeah.
But I will say,
I don't think it's set in widespread anytime soon, but
no,
really
it's not.
Promising.
No. And I always point back to like when, and people always blame Intel for holding everybody back with never doing more cores, but they tried like hell with the 6 core, with the Gulf Towns, those Westmeres. They paid developers to support more cores. They even made HEDT. When, remember, no one bought AMD. It was basically everybody bought Intel quad core. They were pushing these high-end core counts because they wanted it to go somewhere. And again, the demo years and years ago was they paid a developer to support, you know, all 6 cores in a Westmere CPU. And that was probably 12 years ago, and we're still... Now we're at 6 cores. I'm just so tired of hearing it. I want to see it proved at this point. I'm tired of the. Yeah. I'm tired of the promises. Is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Fair.
Well, fun times. Good news or bad news. Whichever way you look at it. I don't know. yeah, and we'll see. We'll see. I wish there was like a nice like line chart. I'm sure maybe somebody, you know, is like taking these numbers and putting somewhere. I'd love to see like I'm a visual person, so like looking at the numbers like hurts my eyes. So I wish I could see like a chart of like how long it took, you know, and like the, you know, the line graph of.
Oh,
yeah.
Although for the practical purposes. So now that 6 core is basically the predominant CPU for PC gaming, what are all your recommendations? What's your base core count for a gaming machine?
I mean, it's still 5600X. Yeah, you know, yeah.
Ideally, you'd get a 5 series, yeah. Ryzen or Core. I agree.
Yeah.
But I think if I was in a budget, like in a pinch, I would be totally fine getting that quad core with hyper-threaded. Like if I was really trying to keep cost downs.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's still doable. It's still very doable, especially in a lot of games.
I mean, and plenty of people saying that in the chat too. You know, it's like, hey, 4 cores is still, you know, just fine.
I think the thing that sometimes when we're talking about this theoretically is that sometimes I feel like a little bit of bias towards the high end seeps into these discussions where it's like, oh, well, you're only going to have 4 cores. But at the same time, I think somebody who is building a 4-core 8-thread system is aware of the reality of that. They're not going to be expecting to turn on all the bells and whistles. They're not going to be expecting to push as many pixels as possible. They know that they're going to have to cut some corners here and there just so that they can play the games, right? Because that's the important part. They just want to be able to play the games.
What's the highest core count on the G parts right now?
6, right?
8.
Is it? 8. That's 5700G.
Oh, wow.
Which is the 5700G.
They don't have the low-end one this time for DIY.
Oh,
okay.
But, you know, the graphics core is better, but...
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Interesting. All right. Well, man, you know, we've been going for a bit. I wasn't able to fit on the slide a Q&A section, but we do have a couple quick questions, if that's okay with everybody, before we get out of here. So over on Discord, if you want to get your question in now, at PC World in the chat, maybe it's a real quick one, we can get to it. But we do have a couple questions over on Discord. There's a link in the description. Go over to the Discord. Awesome community over there. We have a very pertinent question from a friend of the show, Starscream. Said, Brad, did you ever buy that 5800X 3D to upgrade your Ryzen first gen system?
I have not yet because my daughter is graduating imminently. And so I'm trying to save money for her rather than for me. But I do plan on buying probably the 5800X 3D sometime soon.
Oh.
There you go. Also, we got a lot of off-topic questions. Wow.
So, all right.
Let me go back and see if there's anything pertinent. This is a good one. Styfrex asked, should we expect a better encoder for AMD GPUs? Because the quality is not there compared to NVIDIA. And maybe the Intel one is going to be great with AV1. What do you think? We talked about this during the live build, actually. You know, NVIDIA encoder quality versus AMD.
Is it going to get better? Yes. When that's going to happen, I don't know.
I agree. I do think that it's going to, I think Intel has a history of being focused very strongly on content creation, and NVIDIA obviously, you know, and then kicks butt. So it's going to become a competitive disadvantage for AMD soon if they don't do it a little better. So I wouldn't be surprised if we see it improved next generation. Hopefully next generation sometime soon. But that being said, I do also want to say that, yes, while NVENC is better than AMD's encoder, for normal people who aren't doing, like, production professional streams of their own and stuff like that, like, the AMD one is just fine.
Yeah, it's not bad.
So keep it in perspective.
It's not like, oh, this is horrible, we can't use it. It's just like, NVIDIA's is a little bit better, you know. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. And it's, you know, it's two big companies versus a company that hasn't had the money and resources of the other companies.
So I totally forgot. I'm so sorry. A friend of the show, Pyro Cumulus, asked this question, which I was supposed to use to kick off the HEDT discussion. Said, with plentiful PCIe 5 lanes coming to consumer sockets, are big pro sockets coming to an end, or did that already happen and nobody wrote an obituary? So, yeah, that was the one of the initial things that kicked off discussion over.
No.
Yeah.
Answer is no.
We do have a couple questions from the chat. Friend of the show, David Richard, says, I run a small form factor for taking on the road as a trucker. I am running a hybrid cooler on my 3080 Ti with a small form factor air cooler on a 5600X. Similar to my small form factor. Would I get better gaming at 1440p with an AIO on the CPU? What do you think? They don't say which air coolers on the 5600X, but...
It depends on the air cooler, because air coolers, the high-end air coolers are just as good as CLCs. Like, if you have a Noct, you don't have a Noctua on there, because it's a small form factor build. But I would say if you're gaming at 1440p with that setup, you're probably mostly GPU bound still anyway. So, I mean, if you want to do it for fun, you might see some increase in some games a little bit faster that are more CPU bound, but I don't think it would be worth the cost and hassle to upgrade unless you just like doing it.
Yeah, I'll say that, I mean, that's exactly what I have in my small form factor rig is a 5600X with a 3080 Ti. I have a 240 AIO on there. So I honestly don't think it's too much about speed holding it back, depending on your cooler, of course. I think it's how cool is it going to run? You know, is it going to keep it cooler, hold it from throttling? Like, there's rarely, I'm trying to think of the games recently that, like, I was just like, oh, wow, I'm kind of CPU bound here a little bit. There was something, maybe it was Ghostwire Tokyo. I can't remember. Sorry. But yeah, I mean, there are a couple games where you're like, huh, wow, this is pegging the CPU harder than I thought. Oh, no, it was I've been playing Warhammer 40K Chaos Gate Demon Hunters, which is like an XCOM ripoff. It's actually pretty
good.
Ooh,
that sounds interesting.
It's actually really good. Yeah. And I was playing on the Steam Deck and it runs real bad on the Steam Deck, and I'm like, oh, that's crazy. And then I switched over to my small form factor, and it actually it can't, with even with the 3080 Ti, it can't hold 4K 60 on that game. And I looked and I was like, oh, it's hammering the CPU. So yeah, but that's like,
dang,
you know, an offshoot. It's not typical.
I my only comment is, you know, yeah, you're mostly GPU limited, but you also probably have far more severe thermal constraints, you know, because you're operating in your truck. I mean, I guess you're probably running the AC, so the ambient may not be that bad, but I'm just thinking the conditions you're running at are probably harder than most people, most people's homes. So maybe having a better cooler can help, but I'm not sure if the ambient's bad no matter what. Is a CLC going to make a difference over an air cooler? I'm not so sure.
That's
so.
Right. Yeah.
Well, it might help a little. Mention a small form factor air cooler, which tend to be pretty tight. So sometimes I built in, I mean, it really depends on the size of the case, right? We don't know the size of the case, but when I did the A4H2O video and I built in that, so the clearance for an air cooler is like, I want to say like 50, 55 millimeters. So that, I mean, you're really limited on what you can use for an air cooler. So I was getting better temperatures, like I think I want to say like 5 to 10 degrees Celsius by switching out to an AIO. So if that really matters to you and you're thinking less about maybe the performance aspect and more just about longevity, you just, you know, trying to keep your parts alive for as long as possible because you're concerned about how the heat's going to affect it, then it could be worth doing it. But I would agree with Brad that I don't think it's necessarily for the performance aspect. It'd be more just for, you know, other concerns.
That is a good point, though, because you're pretty constrained in a small form factor. Yeah. So those are not big coolers.
We got a question from Private Info. Said, are any of you on staff old enough to have used a machine that ran off 5 1/4 inch floppy disk?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Actually, I did too.
Really?
All of us are.
Yeah.
Whoa. Did you use single-sided 5 1/4 inch floppies, though?
I didn't even know what the difference was. I was a kid. Yeah.
I think so. Because the first system I ever used was an 8088 system. So I'm going to guess it's that old.
It was probably double-sided. It was probably double-sided.
By then already?
I'm trying to think. It might have. I think it probably was because it was it three. Oh God, I can't remember the capacity. Was it 360? I forgot what it was, but they were. I think it was. I think the original 5150s might have been double-sided drives. No, that couldn't have been. It might have been. I'm just saying the pre-PC POSs we all ran were pretty terrible diskette drives.
We have people in the chat screaming Commodore 64.
Oh yeah, so 360 is single sided, okay. But then there was the high density, remember? So no, wait a minute. There must have been a lower than 360. I'm sure there was.
Kelt from Falcon Northwest is in the chat. What's up, Kelt? Says, tell them about tape drives, Gordon.
Oh, the tape drive. You know what tell you the worst thing? I didn't have a tape drive. I couldn't afford the tape drive. So you would spend all day typing in your basic from the magazine. You'd type it in. And then you would finally, at the end of the day, complete your journey to Mount Doom to be able to run it, with fix all the typos. And then like, whoa, what do I do now? I can't save it. Oh, you turn it off. So you would try to delay turning it off as much as possible. But like your parents really want you to sit here with the stupid computer wasting money on electricity? No, you just shut it off. It's all gone. So pre, no storage. But yeah, the tape drives were, yeah.
Oh, that's fun. That's fun. Okay, so friend of the show, CauseMC. Says, does everybody on staff know what a rutabaga is?
The vegetable, yeah.
I have seen it, yes.
I don't think I've ever seen one.
Really?
No.
You probably have.
If I had to pick it out of a lineup, I don't think I could.
It sounds like something.
Don't put them in your mouth.
Rutabaga.
What does it taste like, though? I don't know if I've ever tasted it, or I don't know if I know what it would taste like.
I wish you get a picture of this on screen now, just to be educational.
Let me Google rutabaga.
I'm seeing mention of a 300 baud. I had the 300 baud.
It looks kind of like a radish.
That was the days you had to dial it yourself. So you dial it yourself, and then you would connect it to your modem.
Turnip versus rutabaga. Huh. Yeah. Oh crap. Okay. Cool. Another one from another fun one from the front of the show. Liquid R, is the F-14 Tomcat the coolest fighter jet of all time, or is it just pop culture hype?
Well,
what do you think?
I have a relative who is a retired airplane mechanic, and I spoke to them recently, and they said that so their answer to that question would be yes, major overhype.
Gordon?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's clearly been overhyped. They stopped making it. I can't think of any other swing wing designs anymore, but it certainly is probably the most hyped fighter of all time. So hype is more valuable in a lot of ways. But clearly an F-22 would easily, you know, outperform an F-14. But although I guess, you know, F-14s, if you're in a swing wing mode and you're at low speeds, but nobody flies around at low speeds to get shot down by a missile. So
my vote goes for those old attack blimps that were back in the day. I like those.
do they really have those?
Yeah, there was, I forget what it was, but there was one country that used blimps to bomb things.
Oh, man. I would just think like that would just be the worst assignment. You pissed off the Sarge really bad. Where am I going, Sarge? You're going in the assault blimp. But I'm just a sitting duck. It goes 5 miles an hour.
But can you imagine the first time they did that? Like, who would have anticipated a blimp of all things, right?
So the original story is the first World War One biplanes used in the war were just observation planes. They would fly over and they would observe troops, and then they would report back. And then some person say, hey, you know what? I'm going to bring my pistol up there. And then pretty soon,
like, I'm just going to drop this grenade over the side.
Yeah. Well, it pretty soon didn't turn into like, yeah, let's put machine guns on these. Yeah. So
as a kid, the F-14 being able to have the die cast metal F-14 that, you know, had the wing swing was pretty awesome. Also the A-10, Lewis Law says they were a fan of the A-10. I was a big fan of the A-10 as well.
Yeah, no, I mean, everybody loves the Warthog.
But my dad worked on Apache helicopters. Those are my sweet spot.
Did we cancel the Comanche? I forget.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
You know what game series I want to bring back? I miss the old Janes, like, where they had, like, the Apache games, the helicopter games EA used to run. Those games are awesome, mm-hmm. And there's nothing like them anymore.
I need to buy they added an Apache to a flight sim. I need to buy that. But I looked at it, and I was like, wow, this is actually kind of expensive. But I should just do it. Anyway, all right, cool. Last one, friend of the show, CosMC, Gordon, Golden State in 5 or 6.
I think it's going to be a 6 or 7 game series. I don't know. I mean, honestly, Boston's awesome. For people who've been paying attention, they're an awesome team. A lot of these shots they were making at the fourth quarter last time was like, I kind of saw a lot of the shots happening against the Heat too. So I don't know why people thought like, oh, this is crazy, but I don't know. It's going to be about adjustments. So we don't know. If anybody who thinks it's over, they're fooling themselves. If Boston goes up 2-0, then that's going to be real tough. But if they, I figure it's going to be 1-1, 1-1. So we take one here, we take one in Boston, and then it'll come down to a 6 or 7 game series possibly. So, I mean, think about it. Really, that's the best script the NBA script writers can write.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Because that's 7 games.
You don't want to blow out.
Yeah.
I will say Warriors in 5 or 6 games. Trick question. Nice try.
Oh, nice. Got him. Anyway, all right, cool. That's it. Once again, tune in next Tuesday, 10:30 a.m. PT. We're going to do a fun build challenge. Actually, you know, Brad, if you get a chance, maybe put together something. We'll say it on the show. I know you're not going to be there.
I will try.
But yeah.
I will try.
Yeah, just for fun. But yeah, so bring your own build challenge. Go over to the Discord, put it in there. $1,200 PC only. Put it on PC Part Picker. Give us a reason why you picked the pieces you did. Anyway, Gordon, take us out here.
Oh, sorry. I was thinking about the F-14.
Just always on your mind.
Have you ever seen videos of it when it's like when it's got the wings out and it's in a high G turn, the wings actually kind of bend a little bit. It's like, man, that's a little scary looking. Check back next week for your Fix It PC Talk on the Full Nerd. For audio listeners, subscribe to us on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or Stitcher. Send questions and comments to the Full Nerd at PCWorld.com, and also leave a review every time you do. Someone adds a core to their CPU. Thanks for coming. I'm Gordon Ung with Brett Charkas.
Eddie O'Shell.
Elaine Yee.
Bye, everyone.
And Adam Patrick Murray.
Man.
The Warriors.
everyone needs to go review us on, please, on their content platform of choice, because we want all those cores to go around, and we finally beat the Mac, right? We can finally beat the Mac, finally beat
that consoles. Steam survey had somebody with three cores.
You never know. All right, thanks everybody. Goodbye. Lewis Law says he's on a Mac right now. Oh, geez.